Weeks ago, we used the same scripture litany to celebrate Pentecost, which is the sort of official birthday of Christianity. Pentecost actually began as a Jewish festival, and now it's a Christian one also, that comes 50 days after Passover or after Easter. And that was when the Holy Spirit swept through the disciples and empowered them and moved them and motivated them to such a degree that 3,000 people in Jerusalem joined them. 3,000 people got baptized that one day after deciding to believe in Jesus. No longer just a motley crew of uneducated rural disciples, they were now suddenly a full-blown movement, quickly developing a structure and a purpose and a theology, and after a while, what we know as the church. That was also the introduction of the Holy Spirit into the life of the church, into the thinking of Christianity, and into the lives of Christian people. But what the heck is the Holy Spirit? Now, I know before that, we all had talk of God and Jesus, and they were both clear enough. The God of Judaism was unseen, sure enough, but over a 3,000-year relationship, God was firmly entrenched in the minds and hearts of the Jewish people. And they knew that God, for example, is just, God is active, God demands certain rights, R-I-T-E-S, and certain rights, R-I-G-H-T-S, as opposed to wrongs. Do this, don't do that, and when you do this, do it correctly and regularly. Because God may be unseen, but God is definitely around and interested and ready to come. So the God part, people got. And Jesus is pretty straightforward. He walked the earth for 33 years, flesh and bone, an identifiable, recognizable, tangible presence in the biggest sense of the word presence. We talk about certain people having a commanding presence just by being there. Jesus had it. People used to say about Jesus that he had authority. Even though he had no obvious basis for that authority, people just sort of felt it in him. And Jesus could just walk into a room or into a house or into a village or into the temple or just walk around the countryside, and people took notice. People wanted to listen to him. They wanted to be with him, and they wanted what he had, presence. Plus, he said things, and he did things that were memorable. The Sermon on the Mount, the Beatitudes, the parables, walking on water, raising Lazarus from the dead, healing lepers. And whether you believe it or you don't believe it, people are still grappling today with the physical reality of the literal Jesus. Fair enough. So God is a fairly well-established idea all over the world. And Jesus is a fairly well-accepted and respected person all over the world. If you were to fill up Yankee Stadium with a random gathering of 50,000 people and ask, how many of you believe in God? A lot of hands would go up. And if you were to ask, how many people like Jesus? Even more hands would go up. We were actually at Yankee Stadium this week on Memorial Day with three of our kids and our nephew. Now, my nephew is a mountain of a man, powerful, tall, shaved head, dressed in black from head to toe, and tattooed in a major way, kind of intimidating. So about the fourth inning, the guy behind us leans over, and he takes my nephew's arm and says, so, you're a Christian, just like that. My nephew has a long verse from the Bible that is tattooed probably over 12, 15 inches of the outside and inside of his arm twirled around there. And this fellow behind us had been reading it whenever he could sneak a peek. And then he saw this 8-inch cross also tattooed somewhere, at which point he showed us his arm with his Bible verses and his Jesus-centered tattoos. Later, while standing in the concession line, a stranger said to me, that was very cool, watching those guys explain their tattoos. I like that, he said to me. So yes, I think Jesus could pass muster at Yankee Stadium. What about the Holy Spirit? Would people even know what it was? Now, if it was just some impenetrable doctrine that we could take it or leave it, okay. Transubstantiation, predestination, apocalyptics. But the Holy Spirit, well, that's not really take it or leave it. First of all, Jesus talks about it a lot, as if it's important. Second, it is necessary for the Holy Spirit to be there for us to have a Trinity. Trinity, after all, means three. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Or as some say, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Or as some say, the first person of the Trinity, the second person of the Trinity, and the third person of the Trinity. Either way, you need three to make a Trinity, and Trinity still is at the heart of Christianity. Third, like it or not, the Holy Spirit is one of those tests that some Christians throw at other Christians to decide if they're really Christian enough. And so people will ask you, and I bet it's happened to many here in church, people will ask you, do you go to a Bible-believing church? Or somebody might say, are you in a born-again church? And some will say, are you in a Spirit-filled church? And if you give a blank stare, you've already flunked. So I'm trying to help you to keep from flunking with this sermon. Now, everyone in this room has left for something. You've left for vacation, you've left on a business trip, you've left for college, you've left living in one town for another town. And each time you left, you did your best to prepare for the leaving, packing and planning and shopping, and you know the drill. Well, Jesus knew that he was leaving. He knew that his time was short, his life, his earthly experience was coming to an end. And he knew that if his work was to go on, if his beloved disciples were to have any chance at all at success of carrying forward the work, they all needed to be prepared for his leaving. And so Jesus started talking about the Holy Spirit. Now, I don't know what you think about Sean Hannity. Well, there, I bet your attention, don't you? But for years, he began his radio show and still says regularly, "Let not your heart be troubled." Well, Hannity actually lifted that from Jesus. Jesus introduced the Holy Spirit to his disciples by saying, "Let not your heart be troubled. Yes, I'm leaving. Yes, I'm going away. And you're not coming after me yet. But don't worry, I've got you covered. I will not leave you comfortless," Jesus said. "I will not leave you comfortless." Some of the more modern Bible translations say, "I will not leave you orphans," or "desolate," or "alone." The point being, you're not in this alone. Anything, whatever it is. Now, while Jesus was with his disciples, I mean literally, physically with the disciples, they faced stuff. But they were never comfortless. They were never alone. They always faced stuff with Jesus. They faced opposition. They faced questions. They faced scarce resources. They faced confusion. They faced doubt. They faced storms. But never by themselves. Jesus was always there. That presence thing. But now, here was Jesus announcing that he's leaving. And far enough away that they can't follow. But Jesus says, "I'm not leaving you without support. I'm leaving you with the Holy Spirit." Now, I don't want to make this more complicated than necessary. Yes, the Trinity is a hard thing to grasp. I will save that for a sermon. Let's agree to meet here 25 years from today, and I will explain the Trinity to you. And some of the more spectacular aspects of the Holy Spirit, like speaking in tongues and prophecy, we don't always get that either. Let's just stick to the root of it. Jesus promises that God's Spirit is with us. We're not alone. Thank you very much, E.T. We are not alone. Some aspect of Jesus, some part of Jesus, some power of Jesus is still there. And then the Bible goes on to list some of the benefits of the Holy Spirit, some of the attributes of some of the ways that it works in our lives. The Holy Spirit is called a counselor, an advocate, a teacher, the truth, the breath of God, the intercessor, or my favorite, the rememberer, or the reminderer. All ways of saying, whatever you're facing, you're not in it alone. The Holy Spirit isn't Jesus' physicality. And the Holy Spirit isn't God's law and majesty. It's subtle. It's intensely personal. It's timely. There are times in life when we feel stymied or lost. We don't know what to say. We can't figure something out. We're afraid. We're afraid to choose. We're afraid to speak up. We're just plain wiped out emotionally, spiritually. You're at your end. And that's when Jesus says, the Holy Spirit steps in, clears your head, gives you voice, puts steel in your spine, inspires you. See that word? Inspire. It means literally to put the Spirit in you. Whenever you're inspired, in a theological, spiritual sense, that's God's Spirit in you. Now we say we're inspired by a rock and roll concert. But originally the idea was God's Spirit lifting you up at the right time. Thursday night, we hosted a fascinating young man, Abbas Hamid, at our church. Handsome young man, he's probably 40. He looks about 15. But he's been through hell in his life. Born in Iraq to a Catholic dad and a Muslim mom, that mixed birth exposed him to prejudice and oppression from early on. His dad was imprisoned and tortured under Saddam Hussein and later executed by Islamic terrorists. But Abbas, by law, became an Iraqi policeman at age 18, right at the start of our war against Iraq, a war which he welcomed in hope that it would lead to his freedom. Abbas eventually began working with the U.S. military as a translator, becoming part of a SWAT team, intelligence, special operations, consistently proving himself valuable to our soldiers. And Abbas and our soldiers, they shared the same daily horror of roadside bombings and firefights and terrorists and car bombings and death and destruction on a daily basis. Time and time again, his young life was spared as if by some design, by some divine guiding hand, plunging him into a spiritual whirlwind. He wanted to know, why was he still alive? Why was he spared? What did God want from him? Indeed, what or who is God? His father's brutal imprisonment had led to a whole life transformation from dad and a revived Christian faith before he was murdered. Abbas saw the spark of Christ in some American soldiers, and he saw the almost magical reverence that soldiers had for the Bible. He wanted to know more. He wanted to know God. And as he continued his service to our military, he took a hard right turn into Christianity, and he let that turn become the guiding light for the rest of his life. During the question and answer period, he ended going right where this sermon is going. Despite all the horror and evil that he has seen, despite being, even now, on a terrorist hit list so much so that he can't go back and visit family, despite the wrongs of his own life which shame him, he lives without fear. He lives without hatred. He lives without revenge. He lives a life of forgiveness, even toward the terrorists. He lives a life of love here in America. He lives a life of faith through his own ministry. How does he do it, we wanted to know? How is he not angry? How is he not bitter and not broken? Well, he repeatedly called it the power of Jesus. The power of Jesus, he said, helps him to love his enemies and cast aside his fear, overcome his anger, and heal his soul. But what is this power of Jesus? I mean, Jesus isn't here. He left. He said so himself. I'm leaving. So, what is the power of Jesus? Well, for the sake of this sermon, that's the Holy Spirit. That's the power of God and the presence of Jesus expressed in a new way. It's God at work even if you can't see God. It's Jesus at work even if he's left the building. What stays on is God's Spirit, what we call the Holy Spirit, or the Holy Ghost, the essence of God in Christ, unseen but fully experienced. In one of the short stories in my not-so-new book, I tell a true story from my childhood. We lived way up in rural Maine, across from the farm, and one day a man came home to the farm. He couldn't find his father, so he looked all over, and finally he found his father pinned underneath a tractor. While the father was driving the tractor up a little hill, the tractor flipped over on top of the old man. The son went over there, and he lifted up the tractor and tossed it aside and saved his father's life. And the next day, the son went back to right the tractor. And he couldn't budge it. So what is it? Under normal circumstances, the sun couldn't budge the tractor, but the day before wasn't normal circumstances. Nowadays, we might call it adrenaline. Up there, in that little town of rural Maine, there was no doubt. God gave that sun power for that day, that moment, that tractor. Jesus couldn't be there. He's left. But he left behind just what is needed. And maybe in terms of human physiology, the Holy Spirit worked as an adrenaline rush. At the end, it doesn't really matter what you call it. Miracle or adrenaline, the tractor got tossed aside. Call it God, call it Jesus, call it the Holy Spirit. It's all semantics. It's all theological wordplay that has depth to it in a classroom, but not in our daily life. In our daily life, you and me, we just don't want to be comfortless. We don't want to feel isolated, abandoned, forlorn. Whether in war, or in sports, or in daily life, we're willing to give it our all if we feel there's someone beside us. And that is Jesus' promise to each of us. Let's conclude our service as a lovely sort of folk hymn that we're going to sing as our closing hymn. We're going to sing it twice. It's just one verse. Hymn 259, Spirit of the Living God, 259.